So schemas, we've talked about many times, we'll continue to talk about, because it does seem that human cognition is very much based upon categorical thinking and being able to sort things into categories quickly to make really efficient judgments. They're not always accurate judgments, but they're efficient. They allow us to process information quickly, move through our environment fluidly, and adapt to situations very rapidly. And those are usually advantages unless we accidentally do something wrong in our cognitive processing that harms somebody else or ourselves in a way that we were not aware we could have controlled. Because schemas are largely implicit, I could get you to think about your schemas, but you don't usually think about your schemas. They just operate. When I say can, I don't usually think, well, what's my schema for can? Right? It's just an automatic category, implicit memory applied to a stimulus that I am now able to identify in my working memory by pulling the concept can out of my long-term memory. Right? So schemas, we have already talked about when we were talking about Piaget and the cognitive stages of development. I gave you the ideas of assimilation and accommodation, the ideas of having a category for cat, a category for dog, a category for animal, a category for non-animal, living, non-living. We develop category after category after category that we then use to actually interact and perceive our world. And sensation and perception are different things, keeping in mind that we never just actually perceive raw data. We always edit that data as it's perceived. The sensations are transduced into neural impulses, which then we read or model as the reality we believe we are experiencing. So there's some editing that goes on in that, and we do it in ways that we're not aware of. So that's the implicit memory. Script is a schema for an event. So much like you'd have a script for a movie or a sitcom, and it tells you exactly how things go to film that, we have that for most of our common activities. So eating out has a script to it. You go to the restaurant, right? You open the door, you look for a sign that says what? Wait to be seated or seat yourself, right? That's part of the script. So we go in, if it says wait to be seated, then we wait for somebody to approach us. We don't then go seat ourselves, right? They approach us, then we say, you know, here's the menus. The person may or may not be our waiter who gives us the menus. It might be the host or hostess, right? And then we start reading our menus. Somebody comes in and then takes our drink orders. Then they come back and get our food orders. Then they go away again and they bring our food back. We dine on it. Then they say, well, would you like dessert? And you say yes or no. You then get the bill and you go pay. And that's the script for eating out. And it's weird if anybody violates that script, and most people don't, because that's the implicit operation for how to have dinner out. Me personally, for whatever weird reason of my own, and I couldn't really give you a really good reason, but I like to eat dessert first. I like to order dessert. So I get seated, and I look, and I go, wow, chocolate cake with fudge and on it. Yeah, that's me. And I say, when the person comes back to take the drink orders, I'll say, could I go ahead and get one of these sundaes or one of these desserts right now? And what I usually get is a giggle or a laugh or a smile. Because why? I violated the script. I'm asking for something earlier than I'm supposed to ask for it. And sometimes I get people who are a little incredulous and like, oh, you're serious? You want it now? I'm like, yeah, if you don't mind, I would like to have that as my appetizer. That's how I've learned to say it. I need to say that I want the dessert as an appetizer. If I say that, I'm very likely to get it. If I don't say I want the dessert as an appetizer, I'm very likely not to get it. And people will bring me my food and I'll go, oh, where's the hot fudge sundae? And they're like, oh, you were really serious about that? Because they weren't convinced. They think I'm kidding. I'm off script for a joke. I'm like, nah. And they're like, I'm very sorry about that. And they'll laugh or they'll apologize. I'm like, that's cool. I understand human cognitive processing. If I want to go to Wendy's and get a junior bacon cheeseburger without cheese, I've learned that the best way to order that is a junior bacon burger without cheese. If I say junior bacon cheeseburger without cheese, more often than not, I wind up with a junior bacon cheeseburger. Why? It's the script. It's what they automatically do, because implicitly involved in all of their daily transactions and food service is a way things normally go. And unless you do something to highlight the attention to the fact that you're off script, they'll just go on with script. Not because there's something wrong with them. That's normal human cognitive processing. And in fact, it biases the way we remember things. Because some people go, oh, I forgot to do that. Why do they forget? Probably not because I said it. They remembered everything else, right? But because it was off script. So what we find is, and this is old, old research that goes way back, that we can misremember things in a way that is more consistent with our dominantly held worldview. And that is, looking at 1932, Bartlett had people read unusual stories, so it's not something you'd usually read, and then recall details from the stories. So they're not typical news stories, but they're different stories, and then people would recall the stories, and he'd already surveyed them about their own political views, religious views, et cetera, et cetera. And what he found is they would remember consistent with what they already believed the case to be in their own world. In fact, you can bias memory pretty easily, and lawyers are trained to do this. Elizabeth Loftus showed the fallacies involved with eyewitness testimony. Eyewitness testimony is something our entire justice system relies on, so I hope you see the practical value of some of this knowledge. We rely on people to give a factual account of what happened when they're under oath, right, on the witness stand. And what she was able to do and has done and still does is research memory in such a way that in one particular early study, she showed two different groups of people the exact same film. And then she asked each group the same questions with one word changed. In one group, so you had the same film, two cars came together. I'll just say two cars came together. All right. In one group, they get asked the question, how fast were the cars going when they bumped into each other? And did you see any shattered glass? And in the other group, they asked, how fast were the cars going when they smashed into each other? And did you see any shattered glass? And the people asked the smash question, one word change, reliably reported higher average speeds when the cars collided, and they were far more likely to say that they saw shattered glass. But here's the thing. There was no shattered glass. They edited their own memories, not in a way where they were deliberately deceiving themselves, but they remembered as a fact a detail that did not occur because it was consistent with the stimulus presented to them just before they recalled it. And she's done a lot since then to bring into sharp focus some questions we all ought to have about the reliability of eyewitness testimony. Because the people who get up there are not lying. They swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And they are remembering to the best of their ability. And the more they're pressed to remember something over and over or retell it over and over, the more convicted they become that it is the accurate, reliable, objective truth. But if you ask somebody else who saw the same thing, they'll have a slightly different perspective. Another person, there used to be an old thing that I won't do here, especially post 9/11, psychology experiment that we do in class. Two people come running in out of nowhere, and they get into a big argument, and one would reach up and start doing this to the other person, and that person would fall down, and then you would ask people what they saw individually. And most people would reply that they saw a knife and that the guy was stabbed. But it isn't a knife, it's a banana. But they don't see banana. Their script and their schema says that when you see that kind of altercation, it's a knife. When you hear the word smash, it implies shattered glass. And their memory supplied details that were not present, but which they believe at that point were absolutely present. And that's fascinating if you think about it.